And joining me now in the studio are Vivek Couto of Media Partners Asia and David Bandurski of the University of Hong Kong's China Media Project. Gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us today. Vivek, if I can ask you first, how would you explain Phoenix TV's success?
I think its success is a combination of the charismatic and intelligent leadership of Mr. Liu, and also it's a somewhat unique play on advertising growth in China, which is of course linked to significant economic growth. Of course, within that structure, as your program is showing, there are inconsistencies and problems for Phoenix in terms of regulation, intensifying competition from other broadcasters in China and also some foreign channels, and also the fact that it perhaps has reached its peak now and it's looking for a new direction or a new challenger or a new growth driver.
David, we got a little bit of a taste of Mr. Liu's background and his personal history. Do you think that he holds ideals? Does he believe in democracy? Does he believe in freedom of speech? Has that shaped the way he's run his companies?
He has said in a lot of media interviews, he's talked about his sort of dedication to China's economic development, and this has been another, I think, important part of Phoenix's strategy. But he's also recognized that he's targeting the elite in China and has access to the elite in China, and they also share this vision. They've benefited from China's economic reforms and have a vested interest in seeing that growth go forward. So I think he sees, in that sense, he sees himself serving that overall project, but I think his vision does differ slightly from the party leaders, and I think that does come out in Phoenix news coverage and programming.
Critics, though, still say that they do self-censor.
I think that's a given for anyone who's doing media in China, but particularly Chinese language media. That's kind of the condition of access to media in China, because again and again the Communist Party has affirmed that control of the media is the condition for entry. So that isn't, I don't think, is surprising.
Mm. What sort of competition does Phoenix face in China?
The competition has basically, in some instances, have caught up with them, and in some instances, quite dramatically exceeded them. You've got other people in Shanghai, you know, Shanghai Media Group, for instance, that's producing great stuff, and Phoenix Chinese channel kind of looks a bit dated now.
So how do analysts and advertisers view Phoenix?
Historically, what happened with Phoenix is between 96 and 2000, no one knew about it because it wasn't listed. Then it listed in 2000, and it really was rocketing ahead. It was the only play on China TV advertising that was listed for investors, still is, though there's other Chinese companies, media companies listed, but not in TV. And after a couple of years, then you had the 9/11 and a bit of economic softness, but Phoenix was going down, and there was suspicion because I think Mr. Liu and a lot of the management blamed this performance on, you know, macroeconomic problems. But China's economy, as you know, even during the 2001-2002 problems that the world was seeing in the US and Europe, were still roaring ahead, and a lot of companies like CCTV were growing 30-40% per year, Shanghai Media Group at 20%. And Phoenix was still seeing, you know, 4%, 5% growth, and it seemed odd. And I think that's the main problem that investors and analysts and even ad agencies have with these theories, is how come Phoenix is kind of just crawling around, you know, crawling along, whereas Chinese media is kind of going and growing at a double-digit pace. Phoenix is underperforming that market.
So, David, do you think in a way Phoenix allows itself a lot more freedom because it is a little bit out of the reach of mainland authorities, because it is in Hong Kong?
You can see it, actually. You watch the programming. For every mainland media do this as well. They find, because there are good television journalists and print journalists in China, they have to find ways to navigate the kind of obstacle course of orders and bans and what you can report and what you can't. And they have to find formulas for this. One example I think of is Southern Weekend, one of the finest newspapers in China. And one of the editors in the newsroom used to say, well, we can't always report the truth, but we won't tell lies. And I've heard and seen media interviews with Liu Changle, and he said a very similar thing. He's talked about a kind of commitment to news or to the truth, or not shying away from issues in China's history and its commentaries and documentaries, etc. I think that being in Hong Kong and the one country, two systems does offer that more possibility. In many ways, they can play that game, which they have to, being a Chinese language, especially a Chinese language programmer. They can play that game much more effectively and push the envelope.
Next, cultural revolution, how Phoenix changed the look of news in China.